there is no cap on asylum. And we're just processing those as fast as we can. Our refugee officers are in the same division as our asylum officers. They're trained to do work the others do. And so what we've already done is have refugee officers assisting asylum officers, doing credible fear interviews, doing asylum cases themselves, carrying their own caseload. And you will see more of that continue into fiscal year 2020. So if they're not doing refugee work, they will be doing asylum work. They're only doing one or the other. So they'll stay working in the humanitarian space. And I should note that USCIS is staffing up in the asylum division. So we're adding more personnel overall to attack this backlog.
Are you saying that there's only room in America for, say, 5,000 Christian, persecuted Christians in the world who might want to come here?
The refugee cap was divided up in a way that reflects America's priorities. That doesn't mean there aren't millions of refugees around the world. And, you know, I take issue with how you ask your alleged question, rather a form of an accusation. We're doing the same thing in the asylum space. It's more or less the same standards, but they're here. Refugees, we meet, we go out, we interview them in their home region, and we'll bring them in these categories. But it isn't just the refugee number that addresses the religiously persecuted, as you noted in your question.
Right, but you're saying that if 10,000 religiously persecuted Christians around the world want to come here next year, you're going to tell 5,000 of them no dice. Is that right?
There are 7,500 more just catch-all refugee slots that don't exclude the religiously persecuted. Yeah. I'll take one more. Yes, sir. So we are departing from the previous, you know, at least recently previous regional descriptions of where people would come from to really work it out of the refugee asylum laws where you see religious persecution, those kinds of things. So drawn up by category. So yes, that is a change. Excellent question. And the overall reason that this was drawn up the way it was to serve what the president views as the strategic interests of the United States. And you do see, as I said, the one geographic remnant there with the Northern Triangle countries, 1,500 slots left available. I venture to say that, you know, given the legal standard of a refugee, we may or may not hit that 1,500. We do have a lot of those folks under more or less the same legal standard coming to our southern border claiming asylum. They're in the same humanitarian pool, coming from the very same geographic area, but going forward, they're not going to be able to get asylum at the southern border because the asylum rule has been allowed to go into effect. The third country asylum rule has been allowed to go into effect by the Supreme Court about 2 weeks ago, and that is being applied across the border. So now folks who would qualify that way are going to have to do it from their home country, and we're making sure we reserve spots for that to happen.
Just so we understand the difference between an asylum and a refugee application.
Sure.
Asylum is only when they're here in this country and a refugee is doing it when they're away. Is that how you guys...
That is boiled down, yes. It's the same persecution standards, etc. It's a question of where you pick them up into your system.
I guess I still don't understand what was the logic behind from going with this backlog, whether or not we're going to call them refugees or asylees, the backlog of 50,000, why you decided to lower the caps for refugees?
Well, in part, as you relate those two, it'll be to work more asylum cases. So that's going to happen in the next year. If you look at the total number coming in, refugees and asylees, we took more in, we're taking more in this fiscal year than we took in last year in total. And with the expanding capacity that we have been building at USCIS this fall, we're doing that, ramping up. I think you will see the same thing again in the coming year.
So are you just to be clear, are you saying that, to get back to the Christians, you're saying that, okay, maybe 5,000 in that category, 7,500 in the catch-all. So if there are persecuted Christians in countries around the world, and they can't get under the cap. Are you saying the only other way to get into the country is to just walk across the border and claim asylum?
Absolutely not. We'll turn them back. If they haven't tried to claim asylum in a country they've come through, so this doesn't apply to people from Mexico, for instance, then under the now existing asylum rule, they no longer qualify. We still have a crisis at the southern border that all of these same people that we're talking about, asylum officers and refugee officers, are doing credible fear interviews, they're doing reasonable fear interviews, they're doing what are called CAT, Convention Against Torture interviews. Those are the people that do this. And the workload, as you all know, at the southern border has been immense in the last couple of years, and yet we are still getting to tens of thousands of asylum cases with grants put in place along with the refugees, and those people are being resettled now. I would also note that the president also signed an executive order yesterday giving states and local officials input, veto really, over refugee resettlement in their communities. Now, that really is an executive order that puts more meat on the bones of the law already in place, because they're supposed to have a say under the law now. That's not new, but with the instructions the president gave, there'll be a formal process put in place for that to be achieved.
So
now,
no
take,
way at all,
ma'am.
More than 12,
no, sorry, you've asked questions, ma'am.
Religiously persecuted refugees are
go ahead, ma'am.
Is it wrong to report that?
Excuse me, you're interrupting, ma'am. Well, those talks continue to go on. I wouldn't say, at least not publicly, Mexico hasn't changed any position, nor have we. But we have made progress with the three nations to Mexico's south, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras. There are multiple steps to each of these, but with all three of those countries, we're moving forward. There is a lot more buy-in, including beyond the Northern Triangle, to regional solutions. Costa Rica, for instance, is a tremendous contributor to solving these problems in that region. And as much as we appreciate the partnership in 2019 with Mexico, for instance, with the Remain in Mexico program, we are still engaged with them to try to expand and make more dynamic the opportunities to alleviate the crisis at our southern border and to, and frankly, for the folks who need to be repatriated back to their home countries. Yes, sir, last question. No, I really don't. One of the beauties of being in this job for the last 3.5 months or so is I get to focus on one major issue and run an agency. It's a big agency, 19,000 people. And so I see it going on. I'm blissfully focused on achieving the president's goals in the immigration space. And I really just don't take note of it. I do watch things like I saw President Bukele of El Salvador interviewed yesterday. I watched those because his view and his efforts as a new president down there affect what we're doing. He's doing a great job fighting crime down there. He had some other comments that wandered off into this space that you've asked me about that I just found rather interesting. But I don't have to engage in that space, and I really haven't prepared to do it. So thank you all very much. Sorry, I got to run.